Good afternoon, everyone. Distinguished dignitaries of the government of Odisha, distinguished guests, colleagues from the world of sport, members of the media, ladies and gentlemen, I consider it a privilege to be addressing this esteemed audience comprising of senior functionaries and decision makers of this wonderful state. By inviting a sportsman to deliver this OKH lecture itself showcases the significance that the state provides towards development of sports and its athletes. As someone who has played the sport at the highest level for more than 18 years, having served as an administrator for 3 years, currently I'm serving as the chairman of the ICC Cricket Committee for the last 7 years, and having run an enterprise, 10-week Sports Education Limited, for the last 8 years, which has been a pioneer in grassroots sports education in the country, I'm here to share my ideas on how we could collectively create an impact in the sporting ecosystem and how Odisha can be the torchbearer for the rest of the country. I think the government here, under the able leadership of the Honorable Chief Minister, has already showcased Odisha as a sporting powerhouse and a torchbearer in organizing international events. I have a presentation alongside as well. As the country prepares to witness our athletes compete at yet another Summer Olympics in Tokyo in a few months' time, there's a lot of anticipation in the mind of an Indian sports fan. While we cannot blame the fan for the benchmark he has set in his mind, it's important for us as influencers and decision makers to take note of the performances of the Indian athletes to be able to assess if the course corrective measures that were taken after the Rio Olympics have been able to make a difference or not. It's for long been a popular belief amongst the larger audience that India is a sport watching country and not necessarily a sport playing country. This basically stems from the fact that we do not have enough people taking up active sport, be it for recreational reasons or for competition across the country. At a macro level, I'd like to just introduce you to what I believe are the key factors. If you look at the key factors here, what it takes is you need engagement at the bottom of the pyramid, then you need talent from which you will be able to identify the talent, and then you need the infrastructure, you need the trainers, you need structured training, you need structured coaching, and then of course sports science and nutrition is a very important cog, and of course competitions. These are the 5-6 elements of what it takes to have a proper structure for sports. If you look at the Indian context, while we can put a tick mark against most of these factors, like availability of talent, I think we have plenty of it. Access to infrastructure, yes, currently I put a tick mark, but maybe we can debate over whether it should be green or whether it should be amber. Then imparting of structured training and competition opportunities, I think we still have opportunities there from an Indian context. What we certainly lack is a proper scientific approach to recovery, injury management, and rehabilitation. Due to lack of awareness on sports science as a subject, and most importantly, we do not have a large pool of athletes playing sport at the grassroots level. Although There have been several government-run schemes which have been initiated to address this concern. The implementation of the schemes is not necessarily adequate and hence hardly make any difference. The private academies have been contributing their bit towards increasing the participation at the grassroots level, but unfortunately, all of these are mostly urban-centric. While each one of us in the room acknowledge the fact that we as a society have never provided enough importance to the subject of sport as a whole, what is actually sad is that despite availability of talent and resources, we have not been able to deliver our true potential at the international level. This is the grassroots level engagement. If you look at, while most sports have not been able to capture the imagination of the youth in India, it's interesting for me as a cricketer how a spark generated during the 1983 World Cup has created a revolution of sorts when it comes to the number of people taking up cricket. Today, there's probably no youth in this country who has not played or participated in a game of cricket. And I say this in literal terms. It's indeed fascinating how the large engagement at the bottom of the pyramid has translated into success of the national team at the highest level. Just to give you a stat, India has 52 international venues as far as cricket is concerned. England, who've started cricket in the world, are second behind India. And they have, I think, 23 or 24 international venues. And I'm only talking about international venues. A state like Karnataka has probably more first-class venues or equal number of first-class venues than when you compare it with an England with their international venues. So that's the kind of infrastructure that's available for cricket, and which obviously has transpired into the national team becoming a leader in this sport. There have been various other national associations trying to emulate what BCCI has done in India. While some have been successful in making a difference, most others have failed. But two sports that come to mind, which is badminton and table tennis, are two such success stories. While most urbanites have taken a liking to badminton for recreational reasons, it's indeed praiseworthy to reflect on how table tennis is taking slow yet huge strides towards increasing the number of people playing the sport. Today, pretty much every single school in tier one cities have two, if not more, table tennis tables as part of their infrastructure. The same goes with multinational corporate offices. The recent success of Indian paddlers at the international level has only helped garner more eyeballs towards the sport and has been a catalyst in more youth taking up the sport for either recreational or competitive reasons. As part of our endeavor to understand the overarching dynamic sports ecosystem in India, my team and I put together an analysis on the stupendous success of the Indian contingent at the 2018 Commonwealth Games that was held in Australia. If you look at the Commonwealth medals tally, India finished with a total of 66 medals and was placed third in the overall medal tally. We finished with 26 golds, and that was never achieved in India's history. While sports powerhouses Australia and England led the medals tally as usual, India jumped two places from being fifth at the 2014 Games in Glasgow to third place at Gold Coast. And we obviously have huge expectations for the 2020 Tokyo Olympics. If you look at this chart, it's very clear that Australia finished with 198, England 136, India 66, and then Canada with the other medals. If you look at the sport-based how India did at the Commonwealth Games in Gold Coast, it's very clear that obviously our number one sport, when you look at, there's a clear change in trend. There's a clear change in trend as far as India's performance in racket sports is concerned. It's never been the case. It's always been internationally, we've always been recognized by shooting, wrestling, weightlifting, and boxing over the years. But a rich haul of 14 medals from racket sports is something that has never been heard of. The fact that our players were merely not competing against some of the world's best in sports like badminton and table tennis, but also ended up on the podium by beating them is a welcome change as far as Indian sports is concerned. Interestingly, there seems to be a big correlation to these performances and the change in trend we discussed a couple of slides earlier. The fact that most of the millennials are taking up racket sports for recreation or for competitive reasons mean that there is a proportional increase in engagement at the grassroots level. Higher the engagement at the grassroots level, larger the pool of players at competitions. The large pool of players at competitions ensures that there is a higher level of competitiveness at tournaments, thereby producing better quality players at the highest level. If you look at the comparisons that I've made between England and India, it's just a hypothesis that we believe can certainly work. If you look at this, if you look at the potential medalists, you know, if you analyze India's performance at the 2018 Commonwealth Games, we went a step ahead to build a hypothesis between the number of youth engaged at the grassroots level and the number of prospective medalists that could emerge out from the overall pool. As a reference point, we have formulated a comparative between England and India in terms of demographics. That's the age group between 6 and 14. England has about 58 lakh and India 17.5 crores. We have taken attending school, England as a 90%, whereas we have only taken 60% as attending school in India. And that's close to 10.5 crores. And if you further bring it down, unfortunately, I think the small little picture-in-picture is closing up that competitive youth available there. 2% constitutes to 5.5 lakh youth in India. And that's the kind of opportunities that we see. It can create 30 times more favorable than that one in England. So I think this is a food for thought for all of us who are influencers and decision makers sitting in this room. With a cohort of 525 potential medalists that England have, England were able to produce 136 medals at the recently concluded Commonwealth Games. While India, with a cohort of 10,514, if you look at this, this is the athlete count. And the takeaway from this hypothesis is that despite the immense potential of being able to produce more than 10,000 potential medalists in the country, we have been collectively overlooking the opportunity due to various reasons. If you look at the registered athlete count from an international perspective that we have, when you look at the comparisons, England in boxing has a registered count of 19,000, whereas India has 988, which is barely 10% of what it can achieve. And similarly, table tennis, 5,343, 572. And similarly, in other sport as well, wrestling as well. So not only India is lagging behind in terms of level of sports-based engagement at the grassroots level, we have also been lagging in terms of having enough number of people take up the sport for competitive reasons. As can be seen in the bar graph, we have less than 10% of registered players here in India, while compared to the numbers in England. If you look at the athlete to medal ratio, this is with regard to the registered players in India alone. This is based on, again, the Commonwealth 2018. If you take the hypothesis a little further, if you closely introspect the numbers displayed in the slide, we have tried to correlate the number of registered players to the number of medals won. While we need 539 registered athletes competing at the highest level to bring home a medal, sports like wrestling and table tennis need a mere 65 to 72 registered players. It means that if we can increase the pool at the grassroots in these sports, the ratio to medals versus athletes can be bridged. The bottom line or inference that we have been able to garner from here is that with 572 registered table tennis players, we were able to produce 8 medals at the Gold Coast Commonwealth Games. Imagine what can be achieved if we had 5,720 registered athletes competing at the highest level. Maybe only 12 medals are available in this event, but maybe we could have converted that 8 into 8 golds. But that's the kind of opportunities that we have. Let me come, what I've also done is I've looked at the Odisha context, and that's the India context that I spoke about. If you look at the Odisha contest, I will in the remaining half of my talk, I will look at the Odisha context. And like I mentioned, this state has been a revolutionary in terms of understanding sport, promoting sport, and this is a great place to actually lead how sports in India can be looked at. If you look at this, again, I come back to the first slide that I looked at. Naturally, there are talented athletes in the state. There's world-class infrastructure that's available, and there are high-performance centers. There is, when it comes to sports science and nutrition, that's a tick, because you already have a world-class center in Abhinav Bindra Center here. International competitions, you've been in the forefront. I think one area where I strongly believe that can make a major difference is at the grassroots, which is at the bottom of the pyramid. If you look at that, I mean, this state is naturally blessed with talented athletes, and not just in hockey, but in other sports as well. And the Honorable Chief Minister and his team of esteemed officers have been instrumental in setting up all of these high-performance centers for various sports disciplines. Like I mentioned, you've been a leading light to the rest of the country. To substantiate my claim that the state is not doing enough, like I mentioned, I think all of us in this room certainly know that we looked at certain possibilities where we could make those course corrections, and I strongly propagate that this is something that if the state can look at, we can certainly produce a lot more medalists from the state. To substantiate my claim, if you look at the National Games ranking and the Khelo India ranking, this is where Odisha finished. Given the current scenario, I believe it's high time that we collectively take responsibility and implement course correction measures in the form of how one approaches sport at the grassroots level and make full use of the resources available in the state to produce prospective medalists at the highest level. So drawing parallels from the earlier hypothesis, I have put together a few numbers that indicate the immense potential that the state has in terms of producing prospective medalists. Please note that the numbers for Odisha are extrapolated based on the average percentile used for the hypothesis in the national context, and hence this may not be deemed as final. So this is where I have looked at. If you look at the youth and then Odisha, about 65 lakh attending schools, again I've only taken 60%, and then again sports playing youth, about 3,91,000, almost 4 lakhs. So if you look at it, you almost have 4 lakh youth at the school level playing sport. A pool as big as that has the potential to create almost 400 medalists for the state. Let's for a moment sit back and think that even if we are able to achieve a 50% conversion rate on the numbers provided here, over next 8 to 10 years, the state would have well served with almost 200 potential medalists who could in all probability represent the country at the 2028 Olympics. What is it that I suggest? I think it needs to be looked at in a four-pronged approach. Given the state's vision of becoming the sporting powerhouse of the country, and keeping in mind the various novel initiatives that have been implemented by the state machinery towards achieving this vision, I feel it's imperative for Odisha to buck the trend and take necessary steps to ensure that the efforts put in do not go wasted. To help determine what needs to be done on an immediate basis, I have put together a few action items that need implementation without any further delay. The four-pronged approach that we believe that the state government of Odisha needs to implement in its endeavor to becoming the sporting powerhouse of this country are to ensure access to standardized sports equipment across all schools in the state. Now, I did mention to you about the importance of equipment, importance of standardized equipment. If that can be provided to all schools in the state for a start, that will itself create a buzz among students to go out and play. Establishing an exclusive train the trainers, because without teachers, you can't have students. There's nobody to train students. So it's important to impart a train the trainers program, which can help standardize the sports curriculum across the state. That's something that we lack in the sporting ecosystem. And that's why that was one of the reasons for starting Tenwick as a company to bring about standardized coaching structures. Distribution of scholarships to students, which I think the government is already leading with elite athletes. I think it's important to also look at scholarships for students who excel at the school level. I think the financial incentive will certainly help. Then the other thing that I think we all as sportsmen believe needs to be done is a mandatory allocation of 10% marks in the academic curriculum for achievement in sports. That's something will certainly help kids to take up the sport and remain in the sport actively, competitively for a longer period of time, because we have noticed that the moment there is lack in performance at the in their educational curriculum, then their sporting career drops down, because there will be peer pressure, there will be parental pressure of asking the athlete to stop going or spending more time towards their training. So if you look at the number crunch, what is it that it will take? Having been associated with sport for several decades now and having served at different capacities, I can definitely tell that the state is definitely moving in the right direction and taking huge strides towards becoming the sporting powerhouse in the country under the able leadership and guidance of the Honorable Chief Minister and his team of dynamic administrators. However, I strongly believe that the fact remains that for the state to be able to produce a series of potential medalists, it's important to invest at the grassroots. And if you have to, it's also important to engage sports-based activities at the grassroots level. Experience has proved to us that students at a school can be engaged through sports with an annual budget as low as 1 lakh per school. And you could actually look at a minimum of 3 sports. And most government schools have the play field, have the infrastructure. Private schools don't have that kind of facilities. And that's something that can be utilized at the grassroots level. So it goes without saying that Odisha must take the lead, and which they have in all the other aspects that I just mentioned, and set an example by engaging as many youth as possible. So my final one is, Odisha willing to buck the trend? Thank you.